Psalm 47, 5 through 8. God has ascended with a shout, the Lord with the sound of a trumpet. Sing praises to God, sing praises. Sing praises to our King, sing praises. For God is the King of all the earth. Sing praises with a skillful psalm. God reigns over the nations. God sits on his holy throne. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that we could come together and worship you today. Thank you for Kevin and Heidi Cheng and their ministry, and ask that you'd bless them. And Lord, everything that we've mentioned here this morning concerning the prayer requests, help us to keep those at the front of our thoughts, that we would continue to bring them to you, those requests to you in prayer, Lord. And Lord, we ask that you would work in marvelous ways to reveal your glory in every situation, for healing, for strength, for encouragement. Lord, that they would walk hand in hand with you. You are the one that will lead them to joy and peace. And Lord, we ask for wisdom as we move forward. We ask, Lord, specifically for you to work in a miraculous way in the situation in the Middle East. Lord, that you would be with Israel and the people of Israel, that they would turn to you, Lord God, their Messiah, Lord Jesus. But we do pray for the peace of Jerusalem for Israel. We ask, Lord, for wisdom for our nation, all those in authority to make those decisions. Lord, we ask, Lord, that you would help the people in our nation to draw near to you, and especially for us believers, that we would vote biblically. We pray for the elections, Lord. Help us to know who are the wise and biblically minded people that we ought to vote for. And I know it's really difficult, Lord, because there are many that we just don't have a good option. So help us to know the best. Thank you for this day. Thank you for this time. In Jesus' name, amen. Well, I'm going to turn it over now to Kevin and Heidi Cheng, and I'll let them introduce themselves. I'm just blessed to we're blessed to have them here with us today.
We are so glad to be with you here this morning. So what do you have to expect? So yes, we are from Frontier School of the Bible. We have enjoyed doing music ministry together as a couple, however, for 5 years. And to even backtrack a little bit more, it's all because God brought Kevin from Taiwan to Nebraska. And he's going to share that story with you and how he came to know Jesus through a farmer who took him out hunting. But just as Pastor Lee already mentioned through scripture, as we are here to worship the Lord through music. Well, we've been at Frontier School of the Bible. Kevin has had some time to arrange hymns so that you can join in with us. So it's not only going to be us, it's going to be you and us. And that's what I'm really excited about. So it says in Psalm 33, rejoice in the Lord, O you righteous, for praise from the upright is beautiful. Praise the Lord with the harp, make melody to him with an instrument of 10 strings. Sing to him a new song, play skillfully with a shout of joy. So if you aren't singing or playing, you can shout for joy. So if you think, well, what am I going to do? Definitely all of us can join in worshiping the Lord. So here's how it's going to go. We're going to play an instrumental introduction. Then when it comes to the singing part, I'm going to put down in my violin, and the words are going to come up on the screen, just two verses. And then when I put my violin back up again and stop singing, that means you can just listen. Last Sunday, we had everyone stand and sit and stand and sit and stand and sit. I don't know if we're going to do that this morning. We'll decide, I guess. So we're going to start off with Holy, Holy, Holy Lord God Almighty. Do you have? Okay, I can just come share with you if you need. All right. Do you mean to come share with you? You got it. Okay. our music ministry, we also love to remind ourselves and you as you sing with us, why? Have you ever thought about why do we sing and worship the Lord? And the uniqueness of that in the world. And just as Jesus is unique among all the religions of the world, and that he is the way, the truth, and the life. So our singing praise to him is also unique. And so I have been encouraged by the stories of believers who have found themselves singing in the midst of persecution. A great example of this, I was reading the prison letters of Corrie ten Boom, who found herself locked in a prison cell all day long with nothing. And what did she do? She sang all day long. When I read that, the Holy Spirit convicted my heart because I thought, do I know enough scripture? Do I know enough songs of worship to be able to do that all day long? Now, if the world were to see you singing in the midst of suffering, what do you think they would think? That is strange. Why are they doing that? Where is that joy coming from that seems to be indestructible? And we can say it's Jesus. The next song we're going to invite you to join with us on is called "'Tis So Sweet to Trust in Jesus, Just to Take Him at His Word."
So just yesterday, Kevin and I stopped by a dear friend of ours in Holdridge, Nebraska, who's going to be turning 98 next week. We just started playing these so he could just listen and enjoy, and a way for him to wish him happy birthday. And as we were playing them, we would ask him what he thought it was. We didn't tell him, so everything was a surprise. And he knew every single one of them, and not only that, he had all the words memorized. And that reminded me of something we've experienced as we have played for people who might have dementia or Alzheimer's. They do not forget these things. There's something about the promises of God set to music are unforgettable. And so all the more reason to sing and praise the Lord and fill our mind with those things, because Satan cannot destroy that when we have filled our mind with those things. We have one last song we want you to join in with us, and that's Softly and Tenderly, Jesus is Calling. I apologize, the last one, I didn't give you a heads up. Everything is the same format, and so we try to make it easy for you to follow along.
Thank you.
Now, before we transition into Kevin coming up and sharing his testimony, we do have just an instrumental one we would like to share, but we're going to do the same thing we did to our friend yesterday. We're not going to tell you what we're going to play, but it's going to be a combination of a chorus and a hymn put together, and they tie together really, really well and also lead into Kevin's testimony. So take a listen and enjoy. Any ideas? What did you hear? He is exalted. And I bet once I start singing the words, you would know what it was. Oh, for a thousand tongues to sing my great Redeemer's praise. So the two put together, and how we, if we had a thousand tongues, they should all be singing the praise of Jesus. So I'm going to invite Kevin up to come share his testimony and message.
We want to thank you for worshiping the Lord with us this morning. And just like Heidi said, I'm going to share my testimony, how I came from Taiwan and how I came over here. So, and the Lord brought me over this way. I graduated from a junior high school about 13 years ago. And in Taiwan, you had to apply in order to go from junior high school into high school. So after the national exam, my family and I, we were waiting for the school, our junior high school, to tell us when to send in the application. But rural, tiny junior high school does not get the attention from big music school. So we waited too long, and at that time, we missed the deadline for the music school I wanted to go. So we went to this agency that signed kids up for Korean school, and we look at all the different options, and we pick Nebraska Christian School out of the blue. We didn't know Nebraska is a state. Neither did we know Christian is a religion. So a few days later, I flew in Lincoln, Nebraska, and just a perspective, that little tiny town I grew up in Taiwan has 200,000 people. And it was like middle of the night when I got in here, and someone picked me up from the school, from the airport, and took me to the school. A few hours later, I look out the dorm room window after the sunlight has came up. I look out, and instead of skyscrapers, there was nothing but cornfield. So anyway, so that's in a nutshell how I ended up in Central City, Nebraska. And at Nebraska Christian School, I have Bible classes. It didn't matter which grade you are. At Nebraska Christian School, you have Bible class as the opening class of the day. And so it wasn't my first time hearing Bible and Jesus. When I was growing up in Taiwan, my family faithfully attended a church every single Sunday all throughout my 3 years of junior high school. We attended church because the church had free lunch. So Isaiah talks about people have eyes they do not see, people have ears they do not understand. I was one of those people. I sat through hundreds of sermons and heard the gospel 100 times, and it never clicked. And at Nebraska Christian School, the entire first semester, I learned just enough about Bible and Jesus that I can pass the Bible class. But it was at the first year I was there, during Christmas concert, I met this farmer. His name is Dave. And Farmer Dave, he was listening to me playing piano after the concert was over. And he came over and we started a conversation. We were talking about music to begin with, but somehow the conversation changed to guns. So this farmer popped this question out of nowhere. He said, would you like to do some shooting? And I never touched a firearm, so I thought, well, why not give it a shot? So the next thing you know, this farmer took me out to his farm. And my first time touching a gun was AK-47. So this farmer got me hooked into shooting. And so so started from there, him and I, we got really closely connected. He would take me out on his farm all the time. And fast forward to the next year, when I came back to Nebraska Christian as a junior in high school, this farmer started to take me out deer hunting. And in Nebraska, the bow season go from September to December. But I never practiced bow shooting, so my deer season lasted all 4 months long. But here's the incredible part. Every Saturday, Sunday, Monday, this farmer will take me out deer hunting. And from driving from the school to the river, that drive in the dark, he would share the gospel with me. What is even more incredible than sharing the gospel is he was not only sharing the message of Jesus, but he was also living out of the life of Jesus through that way. If you just picture this, if you are a farmer and you met someone at a Christian school, and he started to call you 5 o'clock in the morning, Saturday, Sunday, and Monday every week, would you be willing to pick up the phone? This farmer, he did. He faithfully came to school, and he faithfully, patiently shared the gospel with me over and over. And it was like I get to hear the gospel 3 days a week, even though my heart was set on I was going to get a deer. But he was so faithful, even though I wasn't responding, he just repeatedly shared the gospel with me 3 days a week until the end of deer season. And so one day, this was a few months after deer season, I asked this farmer, I am not one of your own kids. Why are you willing to do all this for me? And he said, the love I have for you is nothing like the love of Jesus. He died on the cross for your sin. And that was the moment when the Lord opened my heart. I gave my life to Christ because of this farmer. And Book of James talk about in chapter 2, faith without work is dead. And I will show you faith through my works rather than words only. And this farmer truly demonstrated that love of Jesus by faithfully doing things for me, even though I wasn't giving him anything back. But this is why we encourage every people, every place we share with people. We tell people, you don't have to be Billy Graham to share the gospel. All you need to do is buy yourself an AK-47. but anyway, that's not the point. But anyway, we just want to encourage, encourage you. I imagine a lot of you here are probably farmers and ranchers. You don't have to be a pastor. You don't have to be an evangelist to share the gospel. All you need to do is look around. Jesus said to his disciple, as they were walking down the road to Jerusalem, he said, "Look, the harvest is ready. The harvest is plentiful. Yet labor are a few. There's many out there, many out there that doesn't know Jesus as their personal Savior." And all it takes is each one of us doing our part to share the gospel using what the Lord has given us. So that's how I came to know Christ, through a farmer. And Heidi will share briefly how God brought us together.
So a lot of people assume that we met through music, and that is not totally untrue. Kevin, in college, was an ambitious student and would form his own symphony orchestras and use it as a platform to share his testimony. I heard about him, and I thought, wow, I really want to get to know this guy. So I thought I'd sign a contract to be in a symphony, and then it would just be happily ever after. But God definitely had a different plan. And you heard Kevin loves to hunt. Well, our family took as much free venison as we possibly could, and he knew this. So one night, he was sitting on his deer stand. He didn't see his buck then. And so on his drive home, he prayed and said, "Lord, why haven't I gotten my buck yet?" Which I feel like is a really bad time to pray for a deer when you're driving. And so God answered his prayer immediately, and that buck jumped right in front of his car, and boom, he hit it. Okay, so he brought that deer over to my house. I just happened to be home that night. I hear a knock on the door, and there is the man of my dreams with a dead buck. What am I supposed to do? I knew if I said no, I'd probably never see him again. And so I said yes, and we spent our first date cleaning a deer. And that is how God brought us together. But I tell people, I just got Kevin. I got Kevin for a really good deal. Just got him for a buck. So as Kevin and I have been involved in the circles we have been in, we've met lots of missionaries, especially at Frontier School of the Bible. It's been so amazing to be there. And missionaries who have had to go over and learn the language so that they can share the gospel more effectively or translate the Bible. And we have found it's kind of the same way with music. We could play you a bunch of Chinese folk songs, but I don't know if that would be very meaningful to you. We definitely know hymns are meaningful, but we've also learned there's kind of a little bit of a heart language with music that we're going to speak to you coming up.
Thank you.
Okay, so a little bit of heart language, because Jesus reveals himself in our heart language and in terms we can understand. Like I believe it says, I am the good rancher, right? And the good rancher goes after that one that was lost. Or I am the good shepherd, and Jesus cares for us in that way, and he gave his own life for us in a way we can understand and believe and place our faith in. So I know you said you saw bluegrass up in the description. We are getting to that, but as Kevin and I have enjoyed learning the heart language of our history through music, we have come to realize that bluegrass didn't just pop out of thin air. It definitely was an accumulation of styles and cultures as people settled and learned to love and enjoy life here. So we're going to take you on a little bit of that journey. So I visited with a pastor about this the other day, and I asked him, you know, should I have them say yee-haw after that, or what should I do? And he said, well, maybe not yee-haw, but amen is always appropriate in the worship of the Lord. So just giving you some ideas. We're next going to go into a couple of Irish jigs before we transition to bluegrass. Here we go. Thank you. Okay, so now we've laid the musical foundation. So our fiddle music that we have enjoyed for a century plus here in our country was derived from how the Irish fiddled, how they brought that over, how the Scottish fiddled and played their instruments and brought that over. And so that's why we got songs like Turkey in the Straw, among others. And so we're going to transition to people who loved that style and took it into the realm of the praise of Jesus. And so we're going to play you an arrangement of Power in the Blood.
Thank you. So before we play the last piece of music right before the offertory, I just want to share a little bit about what the school, Frontier School of the Bible, is like. And for some of the people here that are maybe considering going to college, what possibility that you might be able to do there. So Frontier School of the Bible is a non-accredited Bible school, and it has a program going from 1 year, like a intensive 1 year Bible training, to as long as 4 year program. And so you can be there for 1 year or 2 year or 3 year or 4 year, but by the end of the 3 years after you have all your Bible classes, the fourth year is an internship. And so they will put students in different churches to serve, or different part of on campus to serve their last year. And so, in fact, in the summer coming up, there are going to be a couple Frontier students doing an internship at Pastor Dean's church in Callaway. And so they put students into very practical area of ministry, not just paper knowledge alone. And so we, as a music instructor there in the afternoon, we are also attending one of the classes on biblical family as well. And it's just really incredible how, like, even us being married, being already married, we can actually get things out at the school too. And there are students on campus that are married couple as well. So there is no age limit, and so it's not just limited to high school student looking for college. If you're in your adult life and you feel like, oh, I want to take a break from normal life routine, you're also welcome at Frontier School of the Bible as well. And every day in the morning, the school have four classes starting pretty early, and then between the two classes, there is a chapel speaker. And so school is very the same Monday to Friday. You have morning classes, and in the afternoon, a lot of students go out and work to help out for them to prepare for the tuition next year. And part of the really incredible things at Frontier is all the staff there raise their own support. And so the students that are coming there, pretty much what they are paying is for room and board and their food at the school. And then the classes is pretty much just very minimum cost. Other than the textbook, I don't believe that there is much tuition cost with it. And so school runs, I believe, right around 3,000 or so a semester. So just for the student here that are going from high school into college, it's really neat to consider taking 1 year of break from normal schooling and to come here just soak in God's word and study God's word, as well as consider potential future ministry. So anyway, I'm going to read a little bit of Bible here before I play the last piece. So if you have your Bible, here's Luke chapter 9, and I'm going to read from verse 57 to 62. So Luke chapter 9, 57, this is what it says. Now it happened as they journeyed on the road that someone said to Jesus, "Lord, I will follow you wherever you go." And Jesus said to him, "Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has nowhere to lay his head." Then he said to another, "Follow me." But he said, "Lord, let me first go and bury my father." Jesus said to him, "Let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and preach the kingdom of God." And another also said, "Lord, I will follow you, but let me first go and bid them farewell who are at my house." But Jesus said to him, "No one having put his hand to the plow and looking back is fit for the kingdom of God." And it is really compact, six verses here. But one of the things Heidi and I have done over the last few years is as we travel around, we go to a lot of nursing home and play music. And at nursing home, there is not much resources out there. A lot of nursing home people, once they're there, they seldom see their family, and very seldom do they see people coming and play music too. So one of the things while we are at Frontier School of the Bible that we do in the afternoon is we still go out to different nursing home and play music, but we will invite students to come along to come to nursing home. But here is the thing, following Jesus and following the world, it looks like a whole different. The world is giving all these promises of you're going to get a financial future, you're going to have fame, you're going to have this and such. But following Jesus doesn't always look that way. And one of the things I always open up the question is I would ask students, "What are you doing this afternoon? What are you doing this weekend?" And most of them, a lot of time I will get the answer, "Oh, well, we don't have any plan yet. Oh, we don't know. I'm not exactly sure what we have going on in the afternoon or on the weekend." And this goes into the summer too. I always open up the question asking students, "What are they doing in the summer?" And one of the things I often hear is, I'm not exactly sure, but I like to serve Jesus. I like to do something in ministry." But then the next thing, when the question comes, I immediately after I find out they don't have any plan, I will ask them, "Would you like to come with us to the nursing home?" And you can almost ask yourself this question too: will you go? Like, will you go to serve those people who can't give you anything back? And most of the answer I ever get so far, we have one student that came along. The rest of the time, once they find out we're not asking them to come along to go to a party, to go do something fun, something that looks really fun or exciting, most of them tell me, well, I had to pray about it and think about it. And then we never hear things following that. But this, when I look at this part of scripture where Jesus is inviting people to follow him with all their heart, a lot of time when we were asked the question, "Would we like to go follow Jesus?" we will all raise our hand. Yes, we like to follow Jesus wherever he goes. But often when the task really comes and it doesn't seem like it's going to have some kind of future promise, financial promise, or promise of fame or something that we think can benefit us, then that's the time when we start thinking, I probably should go do this. Well, I should probably do that. This and that, this and that. And then at the end, it never happened. And so I want to encourage every one of you here, as you go back to to your weekday life, there are many parts of our life that we can examine and see, are we truly follow Jesus wherever he's asking us to go? When we first got married, I love hunting, just like Heidi mentioned, and that is one of my biggest idols. Whenever we go out and serve nursing homes, at the very last nursing home we go to, I'm always thinking, as soon as we're finished playing music, I'm going to dash out into the wood and go hunting. And a lot of time, if I got a little bit of free time, extra time on the weekend, instead of doing what the Lord is calling us to do, I always thought, how can I squeeze in just 1 hour of hunting on my free time? And that over the first 5.5 years of our marriage, I realized that even while I'm doing it, I realized that was my idol. But I always have hard time. I always have hard time saying no. God's got to be first. Jesus got to be first. And so a lot of time we have conflict over that because we will be thinking one person she will be wanting to serve the Lord more, especially at the last thing of the day when we're at the last nursing home we visited. I would be like, we really need to go. I want to go hunting. But Heidi would tell me, well, shouldn't we give the older people a little more time after we finish playing music? Shouldn't we give them a little more time just see how they are doing? But a lot of time I find myself in the boat. I want to go hunt. If I got just a little extra time that I can squeeze out before the sun is done. And so whenever I read this, I see a picture of myself giving excuse that I couldn't serve Jesus with all my heart because I want to serve myself first. And so as we go back to our routine life after we leave church today, I just want to ask every one of you to pray, Lord, where in my life and where in my heart that I haven't totally surrendered to you, that you will help me to bring me closer to you by exposing that part of the idol that we're worshiping our life that is not totally giving to the Lord. So lastly, I'm going to play one piece of classical music. And for the children who want to come, I would invite the children to come closer to the piano. If you would like to, this is Fly of the Bumblebee.
For this morning, I'll turn it back over to you.
We're really blessed to have Kevin and Heidi Cheng here with us today. Thank you so much. And it's crazy to see your hands fly across the piano there, tickling the old ivory, huh? So thank you very much. We're going to take up our normal offering, but I do want to remind you in the back, there's a couple baskets for love offering for Kevin and Heidi Cheng. And just pray for them. They're going to go up to Thedford with me this afternoon. And if any of you are free, I'd love to see you in Arnold at the city park here in just a little while. So would the youngsters come forward, take up this morning's offering? They're sad it's over. So I hear some in the back too, but all right. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful day, and we thank you, Lord, for the skill, the ability, and the love that Kevin and Heidi have for you and for serving, and we ask your blessing upon them, that you would continue to use them throughout the years to proclaim the truth of the gospel and to help people to draw near in worship of you, Lord. We ask, Lord, that you would be with each one who gives today. May we give cheerfully and give as you would have us. In Jesus' name, amen.
You must be about eight.
I'm nine.
Nine. And you must be 10. 11. Ready? We wish you a happy birthday. May your future day be bright. Craig, would you give the closing prayer?
Heavenly Father, today we truly do thank you for this time that we can come and worship you. Worship you in song and music, and Lord, most of all, just for your beauty and your saving grace. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen. You're dismissed.